It's time to put on our thinking caps and interpret the significance of what we've been exploring. Unless it explains, history is trivial. Did you discover anything unexpected this week that needs to be explained? In your explorations of Galileo's life and work, you encountered many different, sometimes contradictory, explanations. With Galileo, misconceptions and urban legends abound. Interpretations of Galileo have varied immensely over time and continue to be disputed even today. Imagine that you are at a coffee house talking about Galileo with a friend. Your conversation touches upon some of the most common misconceptions and contested interpretations. These include the following ideas: that Galileo defiantly said to himself after his recantation, "And yet it moves." That Galileo experimented with dropping balls from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. That Copernicanism was pronounced heretical by the Catholic Church. That Galileo was convicted because of his belief in Copernicanism. Or that Galileo was convicted because he engaged in theology. That he was tortured, burned at the stake, or had his eyes gouged out. That the Catholic Church has apologized for its conduct in Galileo's trial. That we have enough evidence to understand actually what happened with a high degree of confidence. Or that scholars are agreed in reconstructing the Galileo affair. Are these conceptions widespread? How profoundly do they shape our perception of Galileo today? Which of these do you and your friend agree are misconceptions? What is the kernel of truth behind them? How would you reply to a friend who asks you about them? Are there other common but disputed interpretations about Galileo you would add to this list? Two of the most significant aspects of Galileo's work for the history of science are, first, Galileo's trial is the paradigm example of the potentially stormy relations between science and religion. And second, Galileo's advocacy of the power of mathematical methods in science is a paradigm example of how novel interdisciplinary methodologies can be profoundly underestimated by those with more conventional disciplinary training. With respect to the trial, what is your explanation of the trial proceedings and of the verdict passed upon Galileo? Suppose that you are now transported back to the early 1600s. You will eventually become one of the cardinals who refuses to sign Galileo's sentence. But at the moment, that sentence lies still in the future. The trial has not yet begun. Now, trained as a theologian for the church, you are asked by the Pope to serve on an advisory panel to manage the case of Galileo. What advice and counsel would you offer, given the historical setting, that might avert the tragic events of the trial? What points would you make? How would you couch your argument? Finally, with respect to new methodologies, Galileo wrote, "Philosophy, or physics, is written in this grand book, I mean the universe, which stands continually open to our gaze, but it cannot be understood unless one first learns to comprehend the language and interpret the characters in which it is written. It is written in the language of mathematics, and its characters are triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures, without which it is humanly impossible to understand a single word of it. Without these, one is wandering around in a dark labyrinth." How does this quotation from The Assayer illustrate Galileo's significance for the development of a mathematical approach to physics? Why was the power of mathematical methods applied to problems in physics so underestimated at the time? How has your understanding of Galileo changed as a result of the readings this week? What is the most significant implication of what you have learned this week? What is your interpretation?